Hello friends, welcome in the series of industrial safety lectures and the discussion of chemical and process safety management. Under that, we are going to discuss about the safe handling of chemicals. Now, in the previous sessions, we have discussed about the different classification of chemicals. That may be a UN classification. We have also discussed about the MSDS, that is material safety data sheet of a chemical. Then we have also discussed about the chemical compatibility, that one chemical is compatible with others or not. So depending on the properties of the chemicals, characteristics of the chemicals and the reactivity of the chemicals, we have to store, we have to handle different types of chemicals in a particular manner or in a safe manner. So now in this presentation we have to discuss about the safe handling of chemicals and the different parameters that should be observed for safe handling of the chemicals. Now while receiving the chemicals, storing the chemicals and handling the chemicals, because normally in the industries, we are receiving the raw material. We are going to check the quality of the raw material or some other properties of the raw material. Then if it is approved by the quality department, then we have to store these chemicals for hours, for days or for month also. So storing of these chemicals is also important. And when we require these chemicals for process purpose, then we have to handle these types of chemicals. So handling may be a manual handling, that may be a mechanical handling, that may be a automatic handling with the help of some automation or some software purpose. So receiving, storing and handling of chemical is important, and that is why we have to focus the safety way of these processes. So gaseous, liquid or solid chemical substances whose properties are not fully known should be treated as dangerous, because there are more than 5 colors chemicals are available on the globe, and that is why we haven't studied each and every chemical from safety point of view. So if some of the chemicals are not known to us or for new to us, then that should be treated as dangerous chemicals, and then we have to follow the safe operating procedures for the dangerous chemicals. Then avoid contact with the chemical substances. So try to use personal protective equipment, try to use some automatic machines or instruments so that we can avoid the direct contact of these chemicals. Then chemicals should always be handled mechanically or with protective equipment. Then containers and implements which can be contaminated with chemical should be handled wearing gloves only. So if we are going to handle acid, then we must go for the acid proof glove. Likewise, we have to select an appropriate personal protective equipment for handling these types of chemicals. So before finalizing or selecting the appropriate PPE, we must know the properties of these chemicals. And for that purpose, the simple way is that we must study the MSDS of that chemical. In special cases, additional protective measures will be utilized depending on the hazardous characteristics of that chemical. Many highly reactive chemicals may only be used under strictly controlled conditions. So some chemicals may be highly reactive with the water, some chemicals may be highly reactive in the normal temperature also, and some chemicals may be highly reactive when the temperature is increased or the humidity is increased, depending on the properties again. So there are some chemicals which can be react as a violent chemical through the violent reactions, depending on their characteristics of that chemicals. So before handling, before storing, before receiving, we have to follow some safety measures. So there are different types of storage, like liquid at atmospheric pressure and temperature. So normally many of the liquid can be stored at atmospheric pressure and temperature, that is nothing but 1 atmosphere or 760 mmHg, or normally 15 to 25 degrees Celsius, that is called as ambient condition in India. So these ambient condition may be varied depending on the country's atmosphere or the environmental conditions. Then some chemicals may be a liquefied gas which can be stored under pressure and at atmospheric temperature. So the temperature is normal one, but the pressure is higher one. So some gases can be converted into liquids under pressure. So depending on the process again, so for that purpose we must know about the Lindes and Claudes process, and with reference to that processes and with reference to that examples, we have to store these some of the liquefied gases under pressure. Some gases may be directly stored under pressure, and some liquids may be stored as a refrigerated storage of liquids at low temperatures. So low temperature means below the atmospheric temperature. So suppose if you decide the atmospheric temperature is 25 degrees Celsius as an average in India, then less than 25 degrees Celsius temperature is the low temperature. So normally when we are talking about the refrigerated storages of liquids or refrigerants, then the fourth category is the storage type. For example, ammonia or some of the categories of refrigerants, that is latest refrigerants. So some safety tips may be there for the pressure vessel operation, because we have already mentioned that some gases can be stored under pressure, some liquefied gases can be stored under pressure, and some liquids can also be stored under pressure. So when pressure is there, it means pressure vessel is required for storing purpose. And for that purpose, for maintenance and safety tips are there for these pressure vessels. So some of the tips like maximize awareness. So we must know about the pressure range of that particular pressure vessel, then follow all the safety protocols. So with reference to that pressure, what may be the hazard may be present in that pressure vessel or nearby pressure vessel, or maybe in the fittings of that pressure vessels. Then protective devices installations. So if there is a requirement of protective devices installation, that might be a pressure release valve, that may be a safety valve, that may be a rupture disc, etc. So that should be checked and installed for that pressure vessel. Then inspect it anyway. So main inspection for the pressure vessel is the pressure again. So the pressure gauge, then some closed loop systems or the feedback system should be mentioned. Some automatic systems may be incorporated for that pressure vessel to control that pressure under the specified limit. Then replaced when necessary. So in case some fittings, that may be a nozzle, that may be a valves, that may be some gaskets, etc., whatever it may be, if it is damaged or corroded, then we have to replace that fitting parts of that pressure vessel. Then install safety equipment. So we have already mentioned the main safety equipments are the safety valves and sometimes some other mounting and accessories can be required, but normally we require the safety valves like ram's bottom safety valve or spring loaded safety valve, lever safety valve, or some dead weight safety valves. So these are some of the safety tips regarding the storage of some of the chemicals, especially under pressure. Then storage tanks may contain some 10 tons to 10,000 tons of material. So that is can be designed by the arc construction. And sometimes some storage vessels are used to contain the chemicals in the bulk. Bulk means in the large quantity. So that may be in the tons, that may be in terms of meter cube, or that may be in terms of megaliters. So if it is in the liquid form, then we can call the bulk as a meter cube, or in the megaliters or kiloliters. And when we are talking about the solids or the other semi-solids, then it is in terms of tons. So some oil refineries and petrochemical plants or the fertilizer plants have been bigger tanks also. So sometimes we require more than 10,000 tons capacity tanks also. So that is depending on the condition, depending on the application, and depending on the storage capacity. So we can go for that. But again, we have to observe the safety measure while storing such a huge amount of chemicals. If such tanks are there, and if there is a chances of leaks, breaks, or a caught in fire, a great hazard is possible. And one of the example of these is nothing but the Bhopal gas tragedy. So in the Bhopal gas tragedy, MIC is one of the main component, and the storage of this MIC in terms of tons. So that is one of the example where the chemicals can be stored in the tons. When a fire or explosion or a gas leak takes place from a bulk quantity, tremendous efforts are required to control all these situations. Because when we are talking about in terms of tons, when we are talking about in terms of meter cube, kiloliter, or megaliter, then the situation or the scenario is different than the normal one. So that requires a tremendous efforts, that requires a huge manpower, that requires a sophisticated fire extinguishers or the controlling parameters, and then only that situation can be controlled with the help of some competent person, with the help of some firefighters, with the help of safety officers, and some expertise of the persons. So which can damage, which can avoid the property damage, which can avoid the people loss, or which can avoid the adverse effect on the environment. Then one of the parameter is there for storage of these hazardous chemicals, especially when we are talking about the flammable chemical category, then there is a concept like nitrogen blanketing. So nitrogen blanketing is important when we are storing the flammable liquid in the storage tanks. So what exactly the nitrogen blanketing is? So for that purpose, we must know the property of the nitrogen. So nitrogen is an inert gas. So it is not reacted with the other gases. That is why it is called as inert gas. So nitrogen is an inert gas that can be used for the purpose of extinguishing and inserting also. So nitrogen can be inserted into the vessels or the storage tanks, and then we can insert the flammable liquids. Then we can go for the blanketing. So blanketing with the help of nitrogen, that is why it is called as nitrogen blanketing. It means when liquid is stored and we insert the nitrogen for the blanketing purpose, then the flammable liquid can avoid the direct contact with the atmosphere. Because in the atmosphere, there may be moisture, there may be some other gases, and there may be some other environmental factors which can affect the flammable liquid characteristics. And that is why this nitrogen blanketing is required. Sometimes we can use this nitrogen as a extinguishing media. As it is inert in nature, so we can use this nitrogen as a extinguishing medium. So it is maybe inserted or used for the blanketing purpose in different forms. That may be a pure nitrogen, that may be in terms of argon, that may be in terms of argon plus nitrogen mixture, or that may be in terms of argon, nitrogen, and carbon dioxide mixture. So again, CO2 and argon are having the fire extinguishing characteristics. That is why these mixture are compatible and which is useful for the blanketing purpose as well as for the fire extinguishing purpose. The major benefit for the use of inserting a storage tank is that fires are prevented in this tank and there is no fire damage can occur, and depending on the reliability and availability of the inserting systems, it can be considered not to fit firefighting systems for the inserted tanks. So due to this nitrogen blanketing or nitrogen inserting, there are different advantages. So the benefits of this nitrogen blanketing are low storage space, maximum pressure 26 bar, constant discharge, then constant dynamic monitoring, ability to have a main and reserve quantity in a single tank as nitrogen is delivered and stored as a liquid, the pipe size is reduced, then requirement for hydrostatic 10-year testing is not a requirement when you are using a nitrogen for the blanketing purpose. Then cost saving on large systems and more robust system integrity. So these are the different benefits using nitrogen for inserting a storage tanks, which is mentioned in this 8th point. Then there is a different point which is from the storage point of view, and now it is from the transportation point of view. So if some hazardous chemicals are there or hazardous materials are going to handle in your industry, then while transportation of this hazardous material, there are some safety measures should be taken. So an accident occurring during the transport of hazardous chemicals can have the catastrophic consequences. It means the major accidents can be happen, especially when we are talking about these catastrophic consequences, we normally consider as a fatality or the high damage property. So that may be in terms of fire, that may be in terms of explosion, that may be in terms of toxic release, or that may be in terms of the combination of these fire, explosion or toxic releases. Whenever hazardous chemicals are transported, whether within the premises or outside the premises of the industry, then certain measures should be taken to ensure that the potential risks are adequately communicated to all who may come into contact with the chemicals in the course of the transport. Because sometimes when we are handling these chemicals manually, then the persons who are handling these chemicals must know about these hazardous chemical characteristics. Because then and then only they can know about these potential risks while handling these types of chemicals, and they can go for the safety measures while handling these types of hazardous chemicals. So this can be accomplished through labeling or marking of the packages or containers to indicate that the hazards of the consignment. So we have already discussed about the labeling of these hazardous chemicals or dangerous goods, etc., that some symbols should be used, some colors should be used, some number should be used, and the symbols or the pictogram should be used in such a way that this should be standard and clearly indicates that these type of hazard or the potential risk is related with these types of chemicals. So we have to handle these types of chemicals in this manner. So these symbols or the standard symbols, pictograms, numbers or the colors can be utilized for packaging purpose, for marking purpose or for the labeling purpose. So some relevant information for these chemicals can also be placed on a different placards, or by sticking the placards on a different places, or by showing some signs, symbols or the poster on different places. So we have to use these diamond symbols like ASKEM code or the diamond on the vehicles and the containers which are used for transportation of the hazardous materials. So we have already discussed about the ASKEM code, what are the exact dimensions of this ASKEM code are, or the diamonds of these, or the dimensions of these diamonds are, then what exactly the related information of that chemical should be there, like UN classification, UN number, emergency number, then UN symbol, etc. So all these things should be included on the placard or the display on the vehicles and the containers. So these are the points which are related to the transportation of the hazardous material. So these are some of the examples from which you can understand. This is the oxidizer. So this is oxidizing agent. It means nascent oxygen can be created and it is highly reactive with the flammable substances. So it is a 5.1 category, and the symbol of this oxidizer is like that. And then the next one is like explosive category. The color, the background, and explosive symbol with number is already mentioned in this symbol. Then the next example is flammable liquid in the red color, third category. Flammable solid, four number with the symbols and red and white strip vertical. Then dangerous when wet, that is fourth one, but the subclassification is different, and that is why it is indicated by the blue symbol. When wet means it is dangerous when it is contacted with the moisture or when the humidity is more. So this is the substance. When it is a pure substance or isolated, then it is not dangerous, but when it is contacted with the moisture, then it is dangerous. That is why it is clearly mentioned that it is dangerous when wet. Then the next example is spontaneously combustible class. Then it is a radioactive. So radioactive hazard is present with this radioactive chemicals, and the symbol is three blades or the fan type symbols. So these types of symbols, colors, and the numbers can clearly indicate the characteristics of that chemical. Especially when we are talking about these symbols, these are the dangerous chemicals or the hazardous materials, and we are talking about the safety precautions or the safety measures for transportation of these hazardous materials. When we are talking about the general chemical transportation, so these are some of the guidelines when we are transport these chemicals by road, by rail, by water, or by air. So containers are mostly standardized to ensure safety during the transit, that is the transportation of these types of chemicals. When a truck or a tanker meets with the accidents or leaks on the way, it creates a problem. So if there is an accident when the truck or these containers are carrying some of the chemicals by road, so after an accident, there are chances of leakage, there are chances of fire, there are chances of explosion, there are chances of toxic release gases. So depending on the characteristics, depending on the HAZCHEM code, symbol, their numbers, and the UN classification, we have to judge what exactly can be the potential or the potential risk on these tankers or the roads. Then fire or explosion can cause harm to the public or property. So sometimes in kilometer area, these fire or explosion can affect on the people, and sometimes it is a small fire or a small leakage of non-hazardous chemicals. So we have to observe first which type of chemicals are there, and then only we have to take the safety measures. Some chemicals are in a corrosive chemicals, some are toxic chemicals which can cause harm to public, animals, birds, and some other environmental factors. Sometimes grave emergency is created, and sometimes we have to warn the public, you know, which is nearby public, to that tanker, to that storage tankers or containers. So speedy rescue operations, evacuation, and calling helping hands may become necessary in some of the situations. So depending on the situation, if the chemical is flammable, if it is an explosive one, if it is toxic, poisonous, or dangerous gases type of chemicals, then we have to call some helping hands. Then while considering the transportation of these chemicals, one has to consider the physical and chemical properties of the product being handled, whether it is a solid, a powder, a liquid, or a gas under pressure. The type of packing, hazards, and other things like mode of transports should be available. So normally when we are talking about this transportation of the chemicals, there is a concept like TEM, transport emergency cart. So that driver is a trained driver who is having the knowledge about that chemical, who is having the characteristics of these chemicals on paper, that is called as transport emergency cart. So from that TEM card, you can judge what exactly the properties of these chemicals are and how to handle these chemicals in a safer way. Before transfer or transportation of these chemicals, their modes of packaging should be considered. So whether it is to be packaged in a metal container, that is packaged in a corrugated boxes, that may be packaged in the metal container plus refrigerant systems, etc., or whether it is packaged with some nitrogen inerting or nitrogen blanketing type of mechanism. So depending on the characteristics, again we have to decide the type of packaging and the type of mode for the transportation of these chemicals. So these are some of the examples of the symbols and the characteristics from which we can understand there are some chemicals which are oxidizer, there are some chemicals which are flammable, there are some chemicals which are explosive, there are some chemicals which are corrosive in nature, some chemicals which are toxic in nature, some chemicals are stored or some gases are stored under pressure, and some are having the characteristics of toxic to the environment. Some are carcinogen, which can cause a cancer due to the respiration of this type of chemicals. So depending on the characteristics, we have to handle these types of chemicals in a safer way. Then there are some chemicals which can have the hazardous reaction. So some products are hazardous reaction products. So this must be known for the safety of process, workers, and the environment. Because there are some products which are more important than the reaction because of their hazardous nature. For example, if you observe the chlorine. So chlorine is a toxic poisonous this chlorine as a raw material. So if this chlorine reacts with the alcohol, then there may be a chances of production as a alkyl hypochlorite, which is explosive in nature. So there is a chances of explosion. If toxic fumes are to be generated, scrubbers are required. These scrubbers are nothing but the absorber, and that is why these toxic fumes can be absorbed by this scrubber systems. So normally these toxic fumes or acidic fumes or some other fumes can be absorbed by the opposite chemicals, which can nullify the effects of the toxicity or acidity or alkalinity, etc. So these scrubber mechanisms are normally used in the industry where there are chances of toxic fumes, acidic fumes, etc. If flammable vapors are generated, then we have to use the inert gas blanketing, which is we have already discussed, like nitrogen inert blanketing. So nitrogen as an inert gas can be used for the blanketing purpose where flammable vapors are generated. Then earthing is also required for the vessels where there are chances of static charge generation. So if there is a chemical which is transported through the pipelines or which is poor or loaded or unloaded from the storage tank storage tanks or into the storage tank, then there are chances of static charge. So for that purpose, earthing, bonding, connectivity and nullifying the static charge effect is necessary to avoid the hazardous reaction or the potential hazard risk. If reaction products are highly poisonous, like cyanide products or cyanide derivatives like NaCN, HCN, etc., they are to be handled in a closed system. So these poisonous substances should be avoided in the atmosphere. And that is why if you are going to handle the substances like cyanides, then you have to handle these substances in a closed system. So these are some of the safety guidelines for the hazardous reaction products. Then for the pesticides, these are some of the safety tips. That safest way for transporting these pesticides is the back of a truck or a pickup, never in passenger compartment. Then non-porous truck beds, then truck in a good operating condition should be used for transporting these types of pesticides, and secure all the containers to prevent load shift. So pesticide means to kill the pest, we have to use the poisonous substance, and for that purpose, with reference to the pesticide rule, we have to use the packaging container, we have to use the labeling, we have to use the color code symbol, etc., from that guideline itself. And we have to handle, we have to transport these pesticide in a safer way. Then there is a difference or a different classification of dangerous goods as far as the UN is concerned and ADR is concerned. So as far as the UN is concerned, there are different classes of dangerous goods like explosive gases, compressed, liquefied or dissolved under pressure or deeply reclaimed, reclaimable liquid fragrant. Then some dangerous goods are flammable solids, some are oxidizing substances or organic peroxides, some are poisonous or toxic or infectious substances, some are radioactive substances, some are corrosive substances. And as far as the ADR is concerned, with reference to ADR number, the dangerous goods can be classified as emission of gas due to the pressure or due to chemical reaction, then flammability of liquids, that is in terms of vapors and gases, flammability of gases, oxidizing or fire intensifying effects, toxicity, corrosively or corrosivity, and risk of spontaneous violent reactions. So there may be a different classification depending on the UN or ADR, but these dangerous goods should be handled in a safer way with reference to the safe operating procedure. Then there is another point that is called as transfer of chemical by pipeline. Up till now we have discussed about the transportation of chemicals through the container or through the different barrel systems or package system, etc. Now we are talking about the transfer of chemicals by the pipeline. That it means it is normally within the premises, and sometimes if the pipelines are in terms of kilometers, then it may be outside the premises. So when we are talking about the oil refinery, then these transfer of chemicals are nothing but the pipeline with outside the installation. If the other than oil refinery or small and medium scale products are there, and if the small and medium scale companies are there, then these transfer of chemicals by pipeline are within the premises. So normally when we are talking about the petroleum pipeline in terms of some kilometers, then there are specific guidelines that is called as OISD standards. So with reference to OISD standards and with reference to these rules only, there are some safety guidelines or safety tips. So for transfer of these chemicals, especially when we are talking about the hydrocarbons, that may be in the liquid form, that may be in the oil form, that may be in the gaseous form. So the simple example of these chemicals are the fossil fuels. So gasoline products, that may be your petrol, diesel, then natural gas, compressed natural gas, LPG, etc. So for that purpose, there are some safety tips, like it provides for right of way to be acquired with reference to rule 88, then approval from the CC, that is controller, obtained with reference to rule 89, then design as per the standard code or OSD standard 141, made of suitable steel which is safe for conditions under which it is to be used. So whatever the steel or SS or the material which is used for this pipeline, that should be designed with reference to the OSD standards only. So the details of these properties, details of these design guidelines of these pipelines are given under this OSD standards. So there may be a provision for expansion, because sometimes the temperature is increased, like in a summer in India, and in some of the countries the temperature may be increased, and for that purpose the property of the metal is that can be expanded. So the provision for the expansion, sometimes the temperature is dropped, so the provision for the contraction, then sometimes it may be go through the under stresses. So stresses may be a thermal stresses, that may be a cold stresses. So depending on the temperature again, so there should be a provision for the expansion contraction, there should be a provision for the prevention of these excessive stresses, bypass relief walls, then pressure limiting stations, automatic shutdown equipment to prevent pressure rise more than 10% of the design internal pressure, isolation walls at different locations with reference to rule 19, then line criteria underground as far as possible with reference to rule 91, protection against corrosion with reference to rule 92, hydraulic tests at 1.1 times the design internal pressure and maintaining for 24 hours with reference to the rule 93, that is for 12 months, and shutdown procedure, that is a standard or safe shutdown procedure with reference to rule 94. So these are the different safety tips with reference to different rules and regulation and with reference to the OSD standard for the transfer of chemicals by the pipeline within and outside the installations. So there are some other tips like patrolling of pipeline, communication facilities at frequent intervals along the pipeline of length more than 2 kilometers, then checking of gauges, that is pressure gauges, whether it is any pipeline is damaged or any gasket is leaked or any other problems are there, so we can judge from the different gauge pressures. Then booster pump stations at least once a year should be inspected. In addition, alteration only after approval from the CC and power of CC to required relay or repair for public safety and of inspection and examination. So these are the different rules and regulations which can guide us in detail for transportation of these chemicals by the pipeline. Then there is another concept in this regard, that is called as pigging. So pig is a word which can be used for this pigging process. So pig may be a wooden piece, that may be a rubber piece, that may be some composite piece, and which can pass through the pipes. So for cleaning of the pipeline, sometimes we have to use this pig. So we can use this piece of wood or piece of rubber or piece of some other materials, that may be a composite of different components, so that can be used for the cleaning agent. So these picks can be inserted into the pipeline where we have to clean that pipeline from particular distance, and then we have to apply some pressure. So for that purpose, there is a pig launcher that is called as pig launcher. So this is accomplished by inserting a pig into a pig launcher, and it is called as launching station. So from that point to another point, so another point is called as receiving station. So that pig or that piece can be received by another point, and that point is called as receiving station or pig catcher. So that pig or that piece of wood, piece of rubber can be passed with the help of some pressure or external pressure from one point to another point. And if this pig is passed from one point to another point, it means that whatever the foreign material, whatever the impurities are present in that pipeline, that can be cleaned from one point to another point. So that one point is launching station and another pointing is receiving station. So this process of pig insertion and catching the pig and cleaning the pipe is called as pigging operation. Then there are some criterias for piping installation. So the main factors are material of construction, because corrosion and other parameters are there. So for example, we can use the MS in the premises, but sometimes we have to use SS304, SS316, SS different composites for avoiding the corrosion, etc. And then different factors like design and layout, support structures, clamping systems, welding or flange joints, packing, gaskets, walls and other fittings, then easy approach and working platforms and testing and maintenance. So these are the different parameters on which this piping installation is depend. So before installation of this pipeline, we have to judge, we have to study these different factors. The material of construction is selected depending on the nature. So like we already discussed that anti-corrosive nature should be selected first, then anti-toxic should be there, and if it is inflammable in nature, then it is well and good. Sometimes it is depends on the quantity, that is weight, flow and pressure, and other parameters like temperature, viscosity, color, expansion, etc. should be studied for the MOC. Then thickness of pipe, its quality, welding pattern, flanging are to be considered while selecting for the higher pressure and temperature applications, because sometimes we have to use, we have to store the pressure vessels under a high pressure, that is more than 1 atmosphere. Sometimes we have to store chemicals, sometimes we have to pass this or transport these chemicals through the pipelines at high temperatures. So what exactly the effects of this high temperature or the high pressure on the chemicals, on the pipelines, on the storage vessel, etc. should be studied first. For extremely hazardous chemicals, pipes are tested for intergranular corrosion and certified before used. So we have to check first intergranular corrosion, whether these chemicals or these hazardous properties of this chemical are supporting this corrosion rate or not. Then insulation is applied to preserve heat and tracing. Contact tubing can be used for supplying the heat to the inner material. So if it is in the summer, we know that the temperature is higher than the normal one. So that effect can be nullified with the help of the insulation. And if it is the winter, then in the winter season, the temperature is below the atmospheric temperature, so that can also create a cold stresses. So again, that can nullify with the help of the insulation. So insulation means it is a thermal insulation, normally having the thermal conductivity value less than 0.2. so we can use the cork material, we can use the glass wool material, we can use asbestos sheets, we can use some other materials which can be used as a insulation. So we can apply this insulation on the pipeline. Then there is another concept that is called as cathodic protection. So we have discussed about the corrosion, we have discussed about the rusting, we have discussed about the corrosion adverse effect on the pipeline, on the pressure vessels, on the storage or any type of metal. So normally it is a natural process that is called as oxidation. When these metals are exposed to the atmosphere, so obviously in the atmosphere oxygen is present, and this oxygen is reacted with that metal and that can form a metal oxide. So when the humidity is more or the temperature is more, then that can increase or enhance the corrosion rate. So there are different methods to protect these types of corrosion, and one of the important process is cathodic protection, and it is important as far as the pipelines are concerned. So we are discussing about the pipelines, storage, etc., and that is why this particular process should be discussed in this presentation. So what exactly this cathodic protection is? It is a method of protecting metal structure from the corrosion, commonly called as rust, which is the degradation of the metal material caused by a reaction with its environment. If the metal components of USC systems are not protected, they will eventually corrode and leak, causing contamination of soil, groundwater and surface water by petroleum and other hazardous substances. Because in most of the cases, these all hydrocarbons are carried out, or all these pipelines are buried under the earth. It means all these pipelines are installed below the ground level, and that is why this cathodic protection is one of the methods where we can avoid the corrosion phenomena under the ground or under the earth. So what exactly it is? So from this diagram you can observe that there is anode that is called as graphite anode, and this is the tank, or sometimes it is a pipeline. So that should be a cathode. We know that in the cell there is an anode and there is a cathode. So the anode is generally of graphite because the graphite is having the characteristics that it is a anti-corrosive material. So graphite can't be corroded, or corrosion can't affect on the graphite. That is why we are using this graphite rod as a anode. So it is a impressed current anode, and it is connected through the wires, through the rectifier, to the tank or the pipeline, which should be protected first, right? So if you want to protect this tank, then this is acts as a cathode. If you want to protect the pipeline instead of tank, then that pipeline acts as a cathode, right? So this impressed current anode passes through the tank, and whatever the corrosion takes place, then can affect on this anode instead of this cathode. So we can protect this cathode, means we can protect this tank, it means we can protect this pipeline with the help of this graphite anode or impressed current method, which is underground. So you can observe this ground level also. From the second diagram also, we can protect these pipelines, that is also called as sacrificial anode for cathodic protection. So normally when we are talking about the refinery, petroleum industry, petrochemical industry, hydrocarbon, fossil fuel, etc., these pipelines are underground. So sometimes we have to use all the adverse effect of this corrosion should be on the magnesium. So how to select this magnesium? So this sacrificial anode material of construction is in a such a way that this should be more active than the this pipeline material. And if the material which is highly active than the other material, it is obviously oxidized by the oxygen. It means the corrosion effect is more on this sacrificial anode instead of these pipelines. So Mg is more active than this pipe metal, and that is why we are intentionally sacrifice this magnesium for protecting this pipeline, and that is why this method is called as sacrificial anode for cathodic protection of underground steel pipes. So we are going to sacrifice this magnesium to protect this pipeline. So these are some of the techniques which can protect your pipeline or storage tank or pressure vessels, etc., which are very useful. One of the method is impressive current method, and second one is sacrificial anode method for cathodic protections. Thank you.